This is my second favorite place in the whole world. Why is that not number one? It's because you have, if you don't know that already, it's because you haven't seen my home. You haven't seen my hometown. You haven't seen where I live. When you do, you'll understand why this place is number two. Still pretty good, because there's a lot of places in the world. Okay, it's mail time in English Bay. I've been told by some commenters not to backlight myself when I do that. I thought I was giving you guys a nice view of the bay, but if you don't want to see it, fine. I'll just film the other way around. Side note, I often find that a lot of people don't have a good notion of what is personal space. This is too close, lady. Like, you know, this is a beach. Like, circulate, you know? Space yourself from someone who's... No, there's plenty of room. Why does she have to be that close to me? We're gonna ignore that presence. But yeah, it you know. Yeah,
like energy field. My energy field is like, I think it's bigger than most people's, so Pancho's okay.
I'm part of the energy field. It's okay,
like he's included, but this person here, she's like, she's way too close.
Yes, I don't like crowds, and it's Saturday, so
put on your sunglasses as well.
Yours looks super good, Pancho.
Yeah, I'm so glad I got the implants.
Pancho, if you haven't seen the video, go check it out. He got some implants in Squamish so that his sunglasses would stay on, and they're purple, just like his ears and his paws, so you can barely notice them.
Yeah, that was a really good job.
I did them, so. It's a very small mail haul today. We only have two pieces of mail. But hey, it's better than nothing. There's never been a time since I got the P.O. box back in April where we've been to check it and it was empty. So we haven't had a mail fail yet. I hope we won't have any. But there's a lot of people I wrote to that haven't written me back. I'm like, what are you waiting for, people?
Yeah, I mean, write to us. I haven't gotten a letter either.
Yeah, there are no letters for Pancho. So, we're gonna put the... Here it is. Here's the address. I won't have to write it on the screen. You have it right there. There you go. Another person now. Crowded! I noticed this, like, when I was at the Squamish Adventure, and have this long table where, you know, there's just one long table outside and they want everybody to just like eat together. But and I noticed that I found myself eating on one of the smaller picnic tables on the side, and I look like a freaking, like, you know, antisocial person. It's not that, it's that some of us like to have more space. I don't understand this need to aggregate. Everybody's just like flocking because there are few lions and a lot of sheep. So, there's nothing wrong with being a sheep. You like being surrounded with other people. It's safer, blah, blah, blah. It's not that, you know, and a lot of times it's misconstrued. It's taken as either shyness, social ineptitude, which sometimes it is, or being arrogant or condescendence. It's just that we're doing our own thing. It's like Rome, you know, he said, I like people, but not all the time. You know, or I like being around people, but not that close. Like, you know, there's someone there, someone there, someone there. This is like fucking like this. I'm feeling crowded right now. I'm not feeling too good. I could come back, but no, I have a lot of videos to do, so we're just gonna do that. It's just not gonna be as. Nah, anyways, I'm trying to like tune. And like, I'm not in a crowded, you know, it's not like there's people almost touching me. Yesterday I was in a bus, the people were like that, you know, it was full to the front, from back to front of the bus. That's okay, I can deal with that. But like when you're trying to leave some space between you and other people.
Yeah.
Or sometimes, you know, like there'll be a bench and I'll be here and the person arrives and instead of sitting on the other end, they sit super close and I'm like, what the hell did you have to do that for? Like, move, you know? Or there's like, there's an empty coffee shop and you're sitting there and it's empty, and it's like all this space and they come just in front of you and I'm like, what do you want? You know, like, get away. We're loners, we're proud of it. It doesn't mean we don't enjoy social interaction. It's just that we enjoy having space for our brain waves to work uninterrupted. Because when there's a person there, their brain waves or whatever, their energy is colliding with yours. And in my case, anyway, I'm a very perceptive person. It provokes some disturbances. Yeah, it hinders me. That's why I tend to isolate myself from people. I need to be close to other people's activities, but not that close. Okay, enough about that. Oh, thank God, they're gone. Maybe they heard me and maybe they just felt they felt me pushing them. Like, I'm telling you, if you see me and I'm doing something, you can come say hi after I'm done. But like, if I'm actually doing something, don't fucking, like, please don't fucking, like, interrupt. Because you're gonna throw me off my game. Or, you know, a lot of times I'm writing. And people are like, hey, what are you writing about? Or the stupidest question you can ask someone who's writing in a diary. Are you writing about me? I've heard that so many times from males all the time. I've never had a woman ask that. It's like, what do you think? And you're bothering me and you're making me lose my train of thought. So if you see someone writing, please don't bother them. You can ask them what they've done and ask them, hey, hi, I noticed that you were writing. Say, don't bother someone when they are in the act of writing or when someone is recording and they're talking. Don't be like, hey, what you're talking about? What's your movie about? Wait until they're done. Please, would you interrupt someone in the middle of a conversation? So why is it okay to do it to someone who's writing or recording? Please respect, you know, the work of artists. Oh. We're supposed to have our sunglasses because it's mail time. I don't even know if you guys can hear me. I broke my sunglasses, so I don't know if... Can they still hold up? I don't know. Yeah, I mean, they still work. It just kind of looks weird. Should I bother gluing them back or can I wear them like this? I don't know. Okay.
Yes, get on with the mail time.
Okay, Pancho. You need a little, like, you know, prop thing.
Yeah, because when I'm back there, I'm super far away.
Anyway. We got some mail from Paranoids. That's from Marrero, Louisiana, LA. USA. This is a zine. I believe it's a music oriented. Well, it's called Paranoids, you know. Music zine, but they do reviews. So I proposed a trade so that... Oh, it's free. It's a free zine. Free in New Orleans. That's pretty cool. And yeah, it's a music zine. I'm not really a fan of a music zine because I don't see the interest of reading interviews with obscure bands that I don't listen to, but sometimes it can be interesting if people are saying interesting things. Like, for example, the French language zine, Bobby Pins number 7 had really insightful questions that she was talking to a band that I have no idea who they are. Never listened to their music, but the questions and the answers were really interesting. It's just that if they're just like, how did you start? And then, oh, I met so-and-so. We started playing at this place. Okay. Noise. No. It's annoying. Shut up. And, you know, they're citing places I don't know, people I haven't heard of, bands and influences and songs I have no idea about. That's of no interest to me. If they're talking about more universal things that everybody could understand, that's good. They're talking about life, music, you know. So I don't know whether I don't know if it's going to be, you know, it could be. Yeah, it seems pretty cool. And they do zines, the reviews. So I asked them, do you only review music zines or do you actually do per zines? So they said that they did. So I'm going to send them number 12. Might get some new readers for that. And yeah. Interesting. So we're going to read this. And the other one. So thank you for sending it. I will send the Happy Loner 12 when it's printed. I'm still waiting for my friend to bring my typewriter. And I've only got a couple pages written. It's probably going to be 28 or 32 pages. 28. I'm going to try to keep it at 28. And it's going to be printed on July 4th. The zine launch. Saturday, July 6th at the Blends Coffee Shop. Denman and Barclay. Be there or be square. I'll have copies for sale. $3. $3 or $4. I'll see how much it costs me to print it. And this is from Montreal. This is from Megs Fitzgerald, independent writer that I just, I don't know what pronoun they go with, so I'm just gonna say they. I don't know, Megs is not only a writer, they're a performer also. Oh my God, this is so cool. Wow, self-published books, people. Buy self-published books. I'll have mine out at some point when I can figure out the money and how to do it. I need at least $2,000. And I need to finish like writing a book too. Oh my God, this is so cool. Look at the bookmark. That is genius. I've done personalized bookmarks before with pictures of me, but they didn't come in a self-published book. They were just for fun. Oh my God, this is so cool. Yeah, so thank you so much to my friend Amber Dearest, because it's because of you that I discovered this author and this book. Because my friend Amber from Montreal, also zinester, she used to have the zine distro Fight Boredom, which is now discontinued. She was interviewed by the CBC in an article about the disappearance of analog photo books. Amber did a map of all the surviving analog photo booths in Montreal. And in the same article, there was Megs Fitzgerald, which is the author of this book. Wow, this is so nice. Oh my God. And it's pretty big. I didn't expect it to be this thick. So, wow. Thank you. I'm always very happy to give my money to independent people who do self-published stuff. The next book I'm gonna buy is Miranda Elizabeth's second novel. It's her third self-published book. The first one was a zine anthology. We Are the Weirdos. So that's gonna be my next book. But yeah, wow, this is so nice. Did she do the illustrations as well? Like, who did the pictures? That's so freaking cool. Wow, it's all illustrated. Oh my God, look at this. I can't wait to read this. I'm going to start reading this like right after I hit stop on this recording. Oh my God. This is... Oh, I think this was like $20. So worth it, and I haven't even started reading. So yeah, do you remember those photo booths? It was like $4, 4 pictures, 4 minutes. I spent a lot of money in those trying to try want to get a good picture to send to people, to send to my favorite band, Moist. I wrote to them, I sent them cassette tapes, and they wrote me back. If you don't believe me, I'll show you my mail that I have from David Usher. I have that back home. Yeah, they're super nice. I will talk more about that band later on because they're having a 25th anniversary reunion tour this summer, and I'm gonna be there. But that's another subject. So yeah, it's available on Etsy. Look for it. Photo Booth, a biography by Megs Fitzgerald. Megs is spelled M-E-A-G-S Fitzgerald. Let's read a little bit at the back. For almost a century, chemical photo booths have occupied public spaces, giving people the opportunity to quickly take inexpensive quality photos. In the last decade, these machines have started to rapidly disappear, causing an eclectic group of individuals from around the world to come together and respond. What's up, weirdos? Illustrator, writer, and longtime photo booth lover Megs Fitzgerald has chronicled the photo booth's fortuitous history and the events which gave rise to the desperate need to save them. Having traveled in North America, Europe, and Australia, she's constructed a biography of the booth through the eyes of the technicians, owners, collectors, artists, and fanatics. In this groundbreaking book, Fitzgerald struggles with her own relationship to these fleeting machines while looking to the future. Oh, that sounds so freaking amazing. I'm so glad I discovered that person because I didn't know them. So looking forward to reading that and looking forward to discovering more of their work. So on this, we're going to sign off.
I'm going to get an ice cream cone.
Yeah, I think we're going to get an ice cream cone at the Marble Slab Creamery.
Such a good idea.
And so we say bye for now from English Bay. Don't forget to write to us. You will be featured. If you don't want to be featured on the video, just write on the envelope, do not feature me on YouTube. Otherwise, if you want to be featured, just write to us, send us your zine, we'll send you a trade, we'll send you our zine back. So write to us, write to Pancho.
Yeah, my name's Pancho Sanza. I'm a pink koala. And I'm super cool. And if you write to me, I'll write you back.
Yeah, Pancho can write.
There's not a lot of koalas in the world who can write, but I learned how to. Because I like to get mail.
Okay, so write to us. We write back to everybody, everywhere in the world. It's autographed. Ooh, yeah. Yeah, authors, if you sell books, it's always a super nice touch to autograph the zine. Oh my god. I have a few books that I actually bought directly from the author, and that's just so precious to me. Like people I would meet on the train, just people I happen to meet, sometimes online, sometimes via zines or friends or whatever, or just on, you know, on the street, whatever. It's so nice. So yeah, love it. See, I did not realize that I've just started reading the first pages. When I grew up, I had no computer, no cell phone, you know, we had a rotary phone. If you wanted to make a phone call, you either had to wait until you were home or use a payphone. And like using a payphone was a pretty grown-up thing. Like not a lot of kids used a payphone. I did, but it's because I did a lot of grown-up things. I had a bus pass for the big city. I lived in a small town, but I had a bus pass for the big city across the river. I skipped school. I went to eat in a restaurant for lunch. I didn't do what kids did. But yeah. She remarks that was actually our kind of selfie. I didn't realize that, yeah, they are selfies. You know, they're like, we didn't take selfies on a cell phone, but
that was the way to take selfies for us, I guess. It's pretty interesting. And the thing is, you didn't know how it was going to turn out. So when you say inexpensive, they could be expensive if you were, if you're like me and you're very, very hard to please with yourself. And sometimes I had to take them again because none of the four pictures were good enough for me to send to someone, so, or even to keep for myself, because you had no way to know what it would look like before you actually got the finished product. Same thing with the regular film photos. You'd leave them at the pharmacy. Can you imagine? It cost like 10 bucks for 24 poses, and maybe like I was taking selfies with a regular camera. I could have asked someone to take my picture for me, but at the time I was so isolated that I literally had no one I could ask, or it never occurred to me that I could ask a total stranger to take my picture. I was trying in front of the mirror to take my picture with a regular film camera. So it would cost 10 bucks, and out of 24 poses, maybe one picture would be kind of okay. But yeah, so the cell phone era has some good sides to it. She actually, is it okay to say the author actually goes into the history of photography. Wow, that's gonna be so interesting. Oh my God, there's so much work in there. Like, there's more work in there than in one of my novels. You know, whoa. Wow, like, chapeau, franchement, je ne sais pas si tu parles français, mais wow, énormément de travail dans ce livre, c'est merveilleux. Ça vaut plus que 20$, là. J'ai payé 20$ pour ça, puis je me sens quasiment mal, tu sais, de ne pas avoir payé plus. Wow. Magnificent, I can't wait to read this. Oh my gosh.
Sorry.